So Surah Al-Mudathir, the first couple of ayat from Surah Al-Mudathir, these are the ayat that came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, declaring to him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to start his da'wah, to call the people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands him also to be patient. وَلِرَبِّكَ فَصْبِرْ. You have to be patient, Muhammad. Why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after he's calling him and giving him the da'wah, is telling him, you have to be patient. As we know, the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the universe, when he subhanahu wa ta'ala sends prophets, messengers, those who come to the people to guide them, always they find some kind of hardship. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling them, you have to be patient. All the prophets and messengers before Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam were given that command to be patient. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as we said now, he knows that he's a prophet. He got the wahi from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has seen the angel. He now knows that he is a prophet to the ummah, and he has been given the command to go and warn the people against the fire of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to give them the glad tidings that if you follow me, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prepared Jannah for you. The Shaykh here, he mentions some in details the different ways of wahi that the prophets get from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says the first one is the ru'ya, the vision. The second one, ما كان يلقيه الملك في روعه وقلبه من غير أن يراه, that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, sometimes he feels something without seeing the angel. And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in a hadith, إن روح القرص نفث في روعه أنه لن تموت نفس حتى تستكمل رزقها, فاتقوا الله وأجملوا في الطلب ولا يحملنكم استبطاء الرزق على أن تطلبوه بمعصية الله فإنما عند الله لا ينال إلا بطاعته. Means he feels Jibreel, but he doesn't see him, and he gets inspired with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to command him with, without seeing the angel. This is another kind of wahy, feeling that the wahy is coming, and he can get the command, but without seeing anyone. Number three, that the angel will come in an image of a regular man. And if you remember the famous hadith of Sayyidina Umar, when Jibreel came, and Umar describes Jibreel, says he came is as if somebody coming from long journey. His thawb was very white, his lihya and his hair was very black, and he came and he sat down to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he put his hands on his thighs, and he says, "Oh Muhammad, tell me about Islam, tell me about Iman, tell me about Ihsan, tell me about the hour." So when Jibreel comes to the Prophet in an image of a regular person, the Sahaba can see him, but they don't know who is he. They just see somebody coming to the Prophet, asking him or giving him something. And this was another also way of wahy, revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also the fourth one is that he hears some kind of noise, like salsalat al-jaras. It's like a bell that's ringing too hard. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, this was the most difficult one for me. He hears like as if a bell is ringing so loud. And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes into the mood that he will be sweating, and he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will be like away for some time until Jibreel goes away. And then the Sahaba radiallahu alayhim will see, and many of them said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will be perfectly sitting with us. And then suddenly we see him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he stopped talking, and he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is sweating when it is very hot. He sweats sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and this indicates that the wahi was so difficult. It wasn't easy to come to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this is also one time to come as a very loud noise of the bell. And also number five, كان يرى الملك في صورته التي خلقه الله عليها. He used to see the angel Jibreel on his angelic way, and this just happened twice to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Number six, ما أوحاه الله سبحانه وتعالى إليه وهو فوق السماوات. On the night of Isra and Mi'raj, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was given the salah, and Allah talked to him the way Allah talked to Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam. And this also another way of wahy, and there are many ways of wahy, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam most of them. Then after that, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam starts to call the people, and his journey of calling starts officially after the ayat of Surah Al-Muddathir. And he sallallahu alayhi wasallam starts to call those who are very close from him sallallahu alayhi wasallam, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him another ayah, وَأَنذِرْ عَشِيرَتَكَ الْأَقْرَبِينَ. Muhammad, talk to those who are very close from you, your family members. As we all know, who was the first one to believe in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam? Khadija radiallahu anhu, first woman. The first man, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. And he was a friend of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The first young man was Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu. And right after was Zayd ibn Haritha, the other boy who believed in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam in a very young age. Zayd ibn Haritha was the servant of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Khadija bought Zayd from the market. Zayd was abducted and kidnapped by some people, and then they get him into the market and they sell him as a slave. This was a habit and a custom. If you remember Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salam, when his brothers, they put him in the well, and then some people found him. When they find somebody they don't know, they get him to the market and they sell him and they get some money. And he is a free man, but when they sell him, he has become a slave. So this is what happened to Sayyidina Zayd ibn Haritha. He was kidnapped and then he was sold. And then Khadija bought him to serve Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and to help him. And Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam declared Zayd to be his son. The Prophet's sons died in a young age. Only his daughters lived. So the Prophet adopted Zayd ibn Haritha, and he declared in Mecca that Zayd is my son. He inherits me and I inherit him. Until later, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forbidden adoption and told him, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ud'uuhum li'abaihim, call them to their families. He is not your son. And to end this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam permission, when Zayd divorced his wife, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam marries her, which was not a custom of a man to marry the woman of his son. So to end that adoption story, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to marry Zayd's wife after he divorced her. So Khadija, Abu Bakr, and then Ali, and Zayd ibn Haritha, and then started, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam started going to the people, those who know the Prophet very close, because the matter of da'wah was just starting. And if he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam declares it in the public, people will give him hard time. And they did give him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam hard time after 3 years secretly calling people. So imagine if he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam announces everything from day one. So they have like, they will, something bad would happen to him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he started with his relatives. And as we know, the first ones to believe in him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are those who are poor, those who are slaves, because he tells them that Islam equalizes like those who are masters, those who are servants, all are the same in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is no difference in color, black or white, all are the servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Poor or rich, they are the same in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the first one to accept da'wat al-Islam were the poor, like Bilal ibn Rabah radiallahu anhu, Ammar ibn Yasir radiallahu anhu, Suhaib radiallahu anhu, and all these poor Muslims who have seen most of the punishments of the non-Muslims, the kuffar in Mecca of that time. And Ammar ibn Yasir and Yasir's family is one of the first Muslims to be tortured in Islam. And Ammar's mother, Sumayya, was the first shaheeda in Islam. The first one to die in da'wah to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was Sumayya, the mother of Ammar ibn Yasir radiallahu an. So from there, he said, "Now Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam started his da'wah, started his call sallallahu alayhi wasallam." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we can see, the Prophet is hiding and he is giving the da'wah. And he is the best of the humans, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and jinn. And he is hiding in some people's houses. And he talks to the people in a low voice. He doesn't want other people to know whatever he is saying. And they meet secretly and they run. And it will be mostly at night time when everybody is asleep, because he doesn't want anyone to know about that. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if Allah wills, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was capable to give him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the protection and the aid from day one to declare the da'wah. But we have lessons in these things. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to teach us that when a matter of big importance and significance comes to you, sometimes you have to be very wise and very patient, and sometimes you don't tell everyone about what you have. Because sometimes not telling is better than telling about what you have. And this is what happened to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam in the beginning of his da'wah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed him sallallahu alayhi wasallam with eloquent speech sallallahu alayhi wasallam. When he speaks, everybody listens to him. When he speaks sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the hearts will open to him sallallahu alayhi wasallam, because he has a background, a very solid background with the Meccans, to be the most honest and the one that they can trust. And he sallallahu alayhi wasallam was known by everyone that he has never wronged anyone, that he has never lied sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he was always good to the people. So when he called people to listen to him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put love in the hearts of these people, and they listened to him sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And we will see in the future what happened to specific sahaba from the difficulties and adversities on the way of Islam. And sometimes nowadays, sometimes when we get something, we think that we are the most tested Muslims. Sometimes if we lose a loved one, sometimes we lose a family member, sometimes accident happens and something happened to us, and then we think that this is too big. But when we read the story of the Sahaba and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, we feel that we are very small compared to these people who left everything for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who sacrificed their lives for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who gave everything to Allah and to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them back, has blessed them, all of them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala declared it in the Quran that those sahaba ridwanullahi alayhim, we always say Abu Bakr radiallahu an, Umar radiallahu an, we don't just say the name, we say radiallahu an, means may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with him. Why? Because Allah in the Quran said radiallahu anhum wa radu an, Allah is pleased with all sahaba ridwanullahi alayhim. So we have to say radiallahu an. As we say the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, we would say Abu Bakr radiallahu an, Umar radiallahu an, Hamza radiallahu an. Why? Because they have made an oath and they have made a promise to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam when they said la ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, and they fulfilled that promise to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after the battle of Badr, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals a beautiful ayah in the right of these sahaba, and he subhanahu wa ta'ala says about these sahaba that he subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with them and they are pleased with him. فَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ قَدَرَ نَحْبَهُ وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَنْتَظَرُ وَمَا بَدَّلُوا تَبْدِيلًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says رِجَالٌ صَدَقُوا مَا عَاهَدُوا اللَّهَ عَلَيْهِ. Those are men and they have fulfilled what they promised Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with. فَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ قَدَرَ نَحْبَهُ, some of them have died. وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَنْتَظَرُ, some of them still alive. وَمَا بَدَّلُوا تَبْدِيلًا, they did not change the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam after he died sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open our hearts to understand the seerah of Nabiullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us to take lessons from the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and to apply these lessons in our life. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us when we read the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We ask him subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the understanding of the Quran and the Sunnah. We ask him subhanahu wa ta'ala to aid all of us to walk in the footsteps of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that day, the day of Friday, that we believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we didn't see him, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the chance to see him in Jannah, and we have believed in Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam without seeing him, and we love him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam so much that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inshallah combines all of us and gathers all of us with him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to drink from his hand sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from the river of Al-Kawthar in Jannah inshallah bi'idhnillah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive all of our sins. We ask him subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept all of our a'mal. We ask him subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us to come close to him, to help us to be away from the shaitan, to help us to be away from our desires and temptations. We ask him subhanahu wa ta'ala guidance, assistance. We ask him subhanahu wa ta'ala to put the light of La ilaha illallah in our lives, in our hearts, so we can lead the Muslim ummah to a better way of applying the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in our lives. Allahumma aghfir lana ma qaddamna wa ma akharna, ma asrarna wa ma a'lanna, ma anta a'lamu bihi minna, anta al-muqaddim wa anta al-muakhir wa anta ala kulli shayin qadir. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammad, an-nabiyil ummi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim, wa jazakumullahu khayra.